Hold your breath. Make a wish. Count to three. That was anticlimactic. I'll spare you any further theatrics. These notable lines are spoken by none other than Willy Wonka from the 1971 film Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. This first cinematic iteration of Willy Wonka was performed by the late and legendary Gene Wilder, who is a comedian that had a very specific delivery and performance style to whatever he brought to whatever character he was playing. With that said, there were quite a few things that he wanted to bring to the character of Wonka to create a sense of ambiguity. Ambiguity being the key word of today's video. This ambiguity for the character is most notably performed and perceived with the scene that he argued to have put in the film before he even accepted the role, in the scene where Wonka walks out of the factory with a cane. He proceeds to walk across a carpet, fall forward into a somersault, and then pop back up as if nothing was wrong. The genius behind Wilder's intention to have the scene in the film, and specifically in the first scene we meet Wonka on screen, was so that the audience and the characters wouldn't really know if Wonka was lying throughout the rest of the film. And this is great because this is ambiguity at its core. We don't know if we can trust this guy because he just played a joke on us. This ambiguity to his character is consistent throughout the film. You can find this in the absurd tunnel sequence, or the simple mise-en-scene of his office, which has everything halved, partially missing. I believe, though, that this ambiguity is not just in the mise-en-scene, or the specific character attributes and actions that are performed on screen by Wonka. There's another element to perhaps even reveal further depth into Wonka as a character, and that is through musical emotionalism. Simply put, emotionalism is a theory that aims to draw out the perspective of what is brought through the music. In cinema, it is apparent that music can provide and or support several different emotional perspectives or states of being within the world on screen. Certainly invoking the viewer's personal cultural experiences as well as their emotional associations to sound and melody. The pairing of music or sound to visual imagery create a perceived link to moments and characters, emotions, that are all sonically aroused within the viewer and logged simultaneously. To make this very simple, people imbue and create memories and experiences with what they hear and see on screen. It is as much about what is heard and on screen as what is interpreted and brought to the screen by the viewer. Now, emotionalism can be broken down into three key perspectives. The first perspective is the character themselves. Now, whether it's diegetic to the scene or it's a song happening inside of the character's head, the audience is pretty much aware and being told narrative, emotional things about the character depending on what is heard from that perspective. This varies from an overt kind of awareness to the character's emotional perspective to much more subtle perspectives. We are informed what the character is going through or what they're thinking or feeling based on the music that is specifically composed or played for that sequence. The second perspective that can be found through emotionalism is the perspective of the scene or the sequence itself. In a theory kind of way, I see this personally kind of like as what a montage sequence can do, where the sound, music, or melody draws attention to the scene or the setting. I think of this as Star Wars. where we certainly have the perspectives, perhaps, of the characters, but the music is more so uplifting the scene itself to dramatize or draw attention to the tragedy or the anxiety on screen. It's not so much about the characters in this perspective, but more so the dance itself. The third and final perspective for this theory of emotionalism is the audience or viewer themselves watching and experiencing what is on screen or what is heard from on screen. Some examples of this can be seen in scenes where the music is deliberately drawing the viewer in, whether it be through an extra referential cultural thing or through a specific emotional perspective that is forced on the viewer to have to cognitively deal with. This perspective can be found in the brutal Reservoir Dog sequence, or the shootout sequence found in Face Off. Both scenes in this case are engaging the viewer with an emotional perspective with their own cultural knowledge on what is sonically, melodically heard and what those specific songs stand for. Even if the viewer didn't know those songs or where they're from, the melody is very much combating what is seen on screen, thus bringing the viewer's attention to their own personal moral and emotional stakes in the film. Now, these three distinctions of perspectives are not meant to say that they sometimes don't happen in conjunction with each other. Of course, you can have a sequence that transitions between or overlaps all three at the same time.
The lightsaber changes the chord. Watch this. Can you hear the pitch of that lightsaber? It's E. What happens when you take a G minor chord and you add an E to it?
But that's what this study and implementation of emotionalism is about. To access a deeper meaning of a perspective, to gain further insight about what is being narratively expressed. It is here that memory and emotional associations and musical technique all meet. I believe through emotionalism, we will be able to unpack Willy Wonka in the Chocolate Factory to provide quantifiable emotional perspectives and legitimize emotional perspectives in the film beyond what the character may be doing in a specific scene in the background. This will be uncovered through the dissonant ambiguity of two highly specific and subtle, but very important melodic cues in the song, you guessed it, Pure Imagination.
And you'll be in a world of pure imagination.
Just hang in there, trust me on this. Pure Imagination was co-composed by Leslie Brasusi and Anthony Newley, and sung by Gene Wilder, of course, as Willy Wonka. So there's plenty of context outside of the oddity of Wonka as a character that is provided through the song Pure Imagination, which emotionalism intuitively supplies. This is a notable perspective through emotionalism about Wonka and his character because it is clearly from Wonka's perspective, singing as part of the composition itself. Of course, it cannot be understated that this is a musical, which more often than not, pretty much every song in any musical is going to be from the perspective of the person singing that song. The song is primarily in a minor key, which connotes a lot of the cultural zeitgeist of nostalgia and sadness associated with that key. Musical theorist Leonard Meyer writes on emotionalism, noting how states of calm, contentment, and gentle joy are taken to be the normal human emotional state, as if that association to that psychological goodness is associated with more normative musical progressions, i.e. the diatonic melodies of the major mode and the regular progressions of the major harmony. He goes on to say that anguish, misery, and pretty much any other extreme state that differs from a positive sphere Our deviant N are associated with more forceful departures of chromaticism and its modal representatives, i.e. the minor mode. With emotionalism in mind, on a surface level, this deviant mode of the minor key supports a reading of pure imagination to embody that somber tone and that somber perspective. But before we dive into the two specific cues that I will be uncovering through emotionalism to embody this perspective, I'd first like to veer off and talk about textualism. Textualism being another theory that can evoke these perspectives or emotional states of being through the sonic texture of what is heard or played melodically or as a sound. To be more accurate, textualism refers to the textural timbre or the musical melodic color present in a performance, specifically in this instance, vocal performance.
There is no life I know to compare with pure imagination. Living there, you'll be free if you truly wish to be.
The vocal performance by Wonka is haunting, wistful, and nostalgic. And arguably, his delivery supports those emotional perspectives for Wonka as a character, and potentially the viewer's understanding of Wonka, since Gene Wilder sings with his common voice. He simply sings just like anybody else would. Of course, with practice, having done it in a studio, they didn't replace his voice to get it pitch perfect. It's almost this performance that makes it accessible to people who aren't professionally trained, just like he wasn't. With that said, and the minor key involved, it's a pretty significant clue to kind of get a psychological or emotional perspective from who Wonka is, maybe even feeling on the inside.
Nothing! You lose!
But there is a deeper context at play through emotionalism and the musical techniques specifically written in the composition itself that go beyond anything than he's singing in the minor key, he must be sad. Like any other song in the minor key, pure imagination is emotionally suggestive at best rather than methodologically contextualize any real demonstrative emotional resonance beyond common associations to the minor mode. However, a more applicable emotional resonance can be found through dissonance. Time for the cue. During the scene in which pure imagination takes place, a specific three-note cue kicks off the composition, while we have a slow panning shot of the factory in all its splendor. The first note starts on a high B flat, or an A sharp. Then it jumps down an octave to an A, and then moves one half step up back to that A sharp or that B flat. In tandem, essentially, the musical technique at play here is considered a minor second, or the flat ninth, depending on the association. Flat ninth being an octave apart, and the minor second being right next to each other. There is another mode that is under the dissonant category, like the minor second, and is quite notable given its historical context as the devil's interval. The accurate term for this is called a tritone. Now, this interval being two notes played separated by half an octave. And it sounds like this. This mode is one of the most notable auditory illusions that can be quite misleading when utilized in music. And is fairly common more so than you'd think. Such as in jazz music, contextualizing that mode as struggle within the music as struggle in society.
Duke Ellington said when asked why he used so many tritones in his music, "It's my life, that's what my life is like. Just try to be an African American and you'll hear that you need that sound. That's a sound of struggle and it's a sound of freedom."
Although the tritone is not utilized in the composition of Pure Imagination, but a minor second, the two modes do fall under the dissonant category, which is all about ambiguity, arguably the king of charged intervals. Again, Meyer notes on these intervals that the role of dissonance in arousing effect or in depicting emotional states is evident in the practice of the composers. The consonant interval is one which sounds stable and completes itself melodically, and it doesn't produce any specific feeling or necessary movement to other tones. A dissonant interval, however, causes a restless expectation of resolution or movement to consonant intervals. Context is the determining factor. With context as the determining factor, then both what is on screen and what is heard through the melody is a context worth unpacking to try and figure out what this is trying to say about perspectives. As soon as the viewer encounters this scene with that melody, the viewer is instantly put in a bit of a bind, where these dissonant chimes evoke a negotiation between what they hear as dissonance and what they see as a chocolate factory. This, of course, also engages their personal, cultural, and emotional relationship to that tone, respectively, with dissonance as the key category with which this melody interplays. The pre-coded emotive ideas that tension, ambiguity, and unresolve that dissonance provides as a specific musical technique do not necessarily correlate to specific emotional states, experiences, or preferences held by the viewer, such as the commonplace general emotional associations to sadness and worry that come with this mode. Consonance and dissonance are not primarily acoustic phenomena. Rather, they are human mental phenomena, and as such, they depend for their definition upon the psychological laws governing human perception, upon the context in which the perception arises, and upon the learned response patterns which are part of this context. With this in mind, it is more accurate to look at the dissonance and emotion provided through this mode as complexity rather than specific emotional states that could vary from person to person. Complexity is a constant that people can accurately define as opposed to trying to define an emotion. On a study on newborn infants, it was tested to determine whether or not consonant sounds and dissonant sounds were preferable depending on some predetermined genetic idea, thus trying to put the end to the debate of whether or not dissonance is negative and consonant is positive. It was ultimately difficult to determine whether or not the infant's movement was seen as sonic arousal or sonic distress. With there being a slight angle towards consonant sounds, it's ultimately undetermined. What this means overall is that there are only technical terms that can try and accurately define a sonic sound as opposed to definitive proof of emotional states of being. So this comes with the baggage of a definition such as dissonance itself, having emotive ideas that suggest unresolve, tension, and ambiguity, as opposed to there being any hard lines. So when a composer uses this mode, they are also using those technical terminologies to suggest a specific effect, as opposed to a hard-line rule of what one should feel. So rather than using this tone as sad for sad's sake, it's more accurate to say and use technical terms that are quantifiable, such as ambiguity, tension, and unresolve. Again, what is being suggested here can go in any direction. This could lead to resolve, or this could stay that way. And it's up to the person to infer and bring to what they hear in it. Without even necessarily needing all of the technical jargon and definitions, of course, individuals will be able to come up with their own interpretations. This is what I've been leading up to get at. So these emotive and procedural terms exist on paper to explain and define the technical aspects of music intended by the composer first, far before it provokes any listener's emotional associations that stem from those modes. So far before Wonka's voice is even heard in the song to supply any emotional disposition that he may have, the music is already suggesting an emotional viewpoint that spans across several perspectives through this dissonant cue. With a focus on perspective and emotionalism in mind, Wonka and the rest of the characters' perspectives are ambiguous and wrapped in tension, as defined by the technique. But suddenly, with the added context of the character's visible expression on screen, their assumed ambiguity turns to awe by proxy of several visual facial cues for the viewer. Throughout the song, it is later obvious that Wonka's personal perspective is more wistful and apprehensive by way of his vocal timbre, which supports his personal perspective of unresolve and his ambiguous future. The rest of the parents and children continue to marvel in awe and excitement through the song, affected by tension and ambiguity through the exciting newness and unknown possibilities of such a space. The same can be said for the perspective of the scene and environment itself, where the composition continually contextualizes a minor second throughout.
World of pure imagination, if you want to view your imagination.
Again, like awe and wonderment found through the tension of being at an amusement park, the same can be said here for the scene and setting itself of a factory where half of everything is edible and a chocolate river flows through it. The ambiguity and unresolve of Wonka's character as he wistfully moves in and around the environment is quite present. It's like Wonka knows he's trapped himself inside of a metaphorical golden cage of his own design. The environment is just as ambiguous with potential. Who knows what else Wonka built other than the Tunnel of Doom? As for the viewer, this perspective is quite special and insightful. See, at the beginning of the scene, when the cue is specifically heard, the viewer is presented with a long panning shot of the factory before cutting away to the various characters' perspectives, meaning there is no facial confirmation on screen to influence the viewer during this cue, just the factory itself. The viewer is essentially sonically informed to make their own choice about how they feel due to the dissonant ambiguity in the melody. Arguably, if the same cue was arpeggiated as it is, but in a perfect consonance without dissonance, the viewer's interpretation of seeing the factory would be far less dynamic and very prescriptive given the technical associations that come with resolve and a harmonious melody. Without ambiguity and unresolve created through dissonance, there would be far less creativity or intrigue for the viewer to wrestle with in this moment. Again, Meyer comes in to save the day with, "Ambiguity is important because it gives rise to particularly strong tensions and powerful expectations. For the human mind, ever searching for the certainty and control which comes with the ability to envisage and predict, avoids and abhors such doubtful and confused states and expects subsequent clarifications." In short, the unresolved nature of pure imagination's dissonant melody evokes a viewer's emotional imagination to try and solve and explain the feelings that they have sonically. They're working harder to unpack the inherent complexity to what they hear in the melody, as opposed to right out of the gate vibing with a perfect melodic harmony. Dissonance is exactly why this cue works so well to engage the viewer with the scene. By offering an emblematic and dynamic experience to the scene, as opposed to a predictable and resolved one. The same technique can be found across cinema, but utilized for various specific reasons. Probably one of the most iconic uses of this is in the Jaws theme, where we have a dissonant minor second playing the low E and F. The context of that sound, of course, also being played on the lower end of the scale, is solidified with imagery of blood and deep, dark oceans and giant fish monsters. John Williams specifically does this again in the Jurassic... I got so excited there. John Williams does this again later on in his career with the Jurassic Park theme, which, oddly enough, is very close to, in fact, in the same neighborhood of where Pure Imagination's melody is, on a B flat and an A. This creates a similar sense of awe and wonderment through tension, through the ambiguity of a Jurassic Park theme park, and is very similar to the ambiguity and the tension and awe and wonderment of a giant chocolate factory. This is a complex way of saying emotions are fluid, but does bring accuracy to the old adage that you can have tears of joy and tears of sadness. Let's get back to Pure Imagination. Upon the music's conclusion in the scene, as Wonka sings his somber lines and drinks out of his candied teacup, a second cue, similar to the first, plays, but now a little slower in order to signify the composition's end. But complexity and arousal take a turn deeper into this cue, because it's not the exact same as the first cue. This second cue that we're going to focus on now and close this out does something a little bit different. It doubles down on arousal and complexity by adding an additional two more notes to the melody. Essentially, when the first note, the B flat, moves down to the A, a very high C sharp and D sharp are hit simultaneously. Our original melody, now, with the added complexity here in this second cue at the end of the song, we have... If we broke each note down into their foundation and paired them with an interval, we would find a lot of intervals paired up to make a chord. First, the C sharp and D sharp alone add another layer of dissonance to the already dissonant minor second. This, however, is a major second, being that they are spaced apart by one step. A major third between the A and C sharp can be found, adding what is called an imperfect consonance to the mixture, almost to dispute the dissonance, although imperfect. Ah, but we have a perfect consonance present through a perfect fourth found in the B flat or A sharp and the D sharp. All three modes, perfect, imperfect, and dissonance, thus create a wildly complex melody and chord with those last notes. This is the most complex that this melody and cue gets, and it's significant because of not only it signifying the end of the piece, but more so with what we see happening in the scene, which is Wonka finishing his tea and then eating the cup, which is not something anybody probably expected. The significance that this cue here at the end signifies in terms of emotionalism and perspective is that there's something new that has been brought from where we started to where we wound up in just one song. That a new understanding and perspective has been brought forth and understood by the song's end. For if this wasn't so, then the second cue would sound identical to the first and would be expected and kind of boring. From a technical standpoint, the perfect and imperfect consonances bring ideas of harmony and ease to this complex cue, attempting to balance out the dissonance. Here, the technical complexity equals emotional complexity for perspectives. Of course, now, here at the end of the song, doubling down on tension and unresolved because the narrative stakes are higher. This is thanks to the already established minor second and the now new major second present in the melody. This is narratively true for Wonka's perspective because now he seeks a strong replacement to oversee his factory. He has to follow through with his high-stakes plan of finding one of these kids to do that, which is a lot to ask of a kid. However, this dissonant complexity isn't without the imperfect and perfect consonants present in this second cue, coding a potential for resolve and harmonic clarity through these added intervals. That is thanks to the major third and perfect fourth, because the film's narrative momentum must continue and eventually resolve, having a beginning and end, growing from one point to another, even if it's a complex, complicated journey. I hope you can see where I'm going with this. For the viewer's perspective, although all of this may be happening on a subconscious level, this complex melody provokes even more intrigue to try and figure out what direction the film is going to go and what Wonka's intentions are. Of course, the understanding that comes through with this context is all thanks to the composition itself and the composition's use in the scene, with a specific utilization of multiple interval techniques doing two separate things on two different cues. It would have been far easier for the composer just to copy-paste what they did at the beginning, at the end, and maybe not even to have dissonance at the core of the composition, where, once again, resolve would be simpler. As a cinematic text, we may not be able to know anything deeper beyond what or who Wonka is, but musical emotionalism has provided a quantifiable emotive context. By unpacking dissonance, we're able to have a pretty good guesstimation of where Wonka is, where you, the viewer, are, and where the scene is, all thanks to the technique of dissonance to legitimize those perspectives. Everyone will come up with their own and bring their own things to music. In some cultures, dissonance is not associated with the negative connotations or the negative technical connotations that is present throughout diatonic music. Through this, dissonance has been shown to embody a sense of emotional arousal as complexity through ambiguity, tension, and unresolve. Again, it is here that dissonance provokes one's imagination. Using the minor second as dissonance for opening and closing this scene is very important to unraveling and unpacking the emotional potential behind where these characters are and so on. It's actually quite frustrating because most of the sheet music that I was able to find online and even some iterations of the song don't even start or end with these cues. They just start with the melody. I think this is a crucial cue for the film and for the song that should be included in whatever performance of the song. Because without it, we're losing that context of how it began. And I disagree with the idea that these two cues aren't part of the main song. I just really don't. It's too many instances where that minor second is utilized throughout the piece that, without it in its full context, it really does lose some of that imagination. It loses some of that magic. This all works so well to engage and pull the viewer into the world of the factory and the story. In a way, the audience, on a subconscious level, won't be able to predict where this will turn out. Now, of course, this is a story that's really old as time almost. We almost see this paralleled throughout other stories everywhere. This certainly isn't my first time watching the film, and I obviously was able to anticipate and glean out some sense of where this might be going, but I didn't think it was going to go this far and that it would actually be the soundtrack, the composition, the melody that is doing a lot of that subconscious heavy lifting underneath. A lot of times it's easier to fall into a story by how a character holds themselves and how they perform, how the story will unfold, and it's easy to miss out on the musical cues that are there doing that work, doing the service, if done correctly, doing the service of supporting the story. I mean, Don't get me started on Kingdom Hearts. Music is the sole reason why I got into the story in the first place. I had to find out why they were feeling those musical feelings. The opportunity to miss that could have been really easy and probably would have made this film that much less memorable. The song is, in a way, kind of culturally iconic, having spurred several covers and this idea of nostalgia around the film, but I think that's due largely in part to the melody itself, utilizing complex techniques to trigger one's own imagination, their own memory, trying to resolve a childhood memory of what this music's actually doing and finding that out years later. Now, of course, the film is problematic in many other ways, whether it be narrative inconsistencies, social, political, capital consumerist, worker, boss dynamic issues, the frivolousness of it all. At least there's an imperfect song here, using an imperfect technique to give me an imperfect memory that still makes me try and think and figure out where it was all going. Where we were back then, trying to imagine what it was really like back in 1971 and where we are now here in 2022. At least the dwelling space that is created and that I store the memory of this music in is just for me, just like anyone else will have their own memories associated to the song. I remember the first time that I was brought back to this specific song, and it was through some obscure Steven Universe edit that had a specific piano version of Pure Imagination playing. That unlocked something inside my head that just made me have to try and find that specific song edit and then find out more about the song itself and down to this road where we are now. It is the end of the video, and I'm sure at this point you have kind of picked up that I've used a lot of the vocabulary very specifically, and that is largely because I am not a trained musical theorist or person in any sense. I am a musician, but I can't really read sheet music very well. This video itself is spurred off of an essay that is required for a music and film class that I participated in. I'm sure there's a lot more to expand on this concept and to talk about other things. I didn't even hit on iconicism, and I barely touched on textualism for a bit. You know, there's definitely a lot more involved that I won't and didn't have time to do for this video. In the end, Wonka ensures his legacy. Charlie gets a factory and is lifted out of poverty. And I get a song. Song that I'm gonna remember forever. Sounds so cheesy. It sounds cheesy, but it's true. I get to go on recontextualizing the song in my own experience and imagining and hoping for my own form of dreams coming true. Or at the very least, having a song to listen to on my phone while I walk at the park and mull over my anxieties, drinking a cup of tea and then eating the cup.